Hi friends, I'm Srishti Jain and today we are going to do 5 questions of finance. So it is not necessary that in finance you'll be asked only the current affair questions. You must have the basic knowledge of the Indian financial system as well and the static finance. So today we are going to cover some parts of the financial management and Indian financial system. So do pay the attention till the end of the video. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon. Now, starting with the first question for today, the question says a firm operates to earn profit and to increase the wealth of its shareholders. Minimum rate of return that a firm must earn in order to satisfy its investors is also known as. So, the question is asking that if there is a company and it is earning a minimum rate of return so that in order to satisfy its investors. So what is that term known as? So in the next slide, we will be discussing these 4 terms and then it will be easier for us to answer this question. The first one says average return on investment. So suppose for 3 years, the annual rate of returns are 10%, 8% and 12% respectively. So the average rate of return will be by adding these rate of return and dividing it by the number of years. So it comes out to be 10%. So this is the average return on investment. Then we have weighted average cost of capital. So as we all know that a company has to borrow funds or it may use its own funds. So there is a cost associated to each of the funds. For example, if it borrows debt, then it has to pay some interest. So we denote KD as the cost of debentures or the cost of borrowings. Then we have the cost of equity as well. And then we have cost of preference shares. So in order to find the weighted average cost of capital, we associate the weights. That is, we associate that how much amount of these funds are used in the capital structure of a company. So this is the minimum rate of return that a company has to earn so as to satisfy its investors, because to each of the investors it has to pay certain amount of return. Then we have the net profit ratio. Now the net profit ratio is basically a profitability ratio which is expressed as a percentage and hence it is multiplied by 100. So it is calculated by profit after interest divided by the sales revenue multiplied by 100. So this is the net profit. And then we have the cost of borrowing. So it refers to the total amount a debtor pays to secure a loan and use funds. For example, if Ram takes a loan from Shyam, then Ram has to pay the principal amount as well as the interest. So this will be the cost of borrowing for Ram. Now let's move back to the question to answer it. So the answer to this question will be weighted average cost of capital, because this is the minimum rate of return a firm earns to pay to its debt holders, equity shareholders or the preference holders in order to satisfy them. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now the question says that the regional rural banks are Indian scheduled commercial banks operating at regional level in different states of India. They have been created with a view of serving primarily the rural areas of India with the basic banking and financial services. So based on which of the following committee's recommendations were the RBIs were established in the year 1975 under a presidential ordinance? So these RRBs were created based on the recommendations of one of the following committee. Now in the next slide, we will be discussing the major recommendations of each of the following committee. And then we will move back to the question to answer it. So the first committee is Bhandari Committee and it was formed in the year 1994. And its major contribution is related to the restructuring of RRBs. So this committee made wide-ranging recommendations relating to the appointment of the chairman, CEO, or the delineation of the roles and responsibilities of the supervising agencies of RRBs. So special emphasis was laid on skills upgradation of the staff of RRBs. So these are some of the recommendations working towards the restructuring of RRBs to make it more efficient. Then we have Narasimham Committee. So based on the Narasimham Committee recommendations, the first 5 RRBs were established based on its recommendations on 2nd October 1975 under a presidential ordinance. So I would like to ask you all a question, that which was the first RRB established here? What was the name of that RRB? So I'll be looking forward to the comment section below. Then we have the Kelkar Committee. So what is it? So a working group on the regional rural banks was formed, and Kelkar Committee was there in 1984. So its major contribution was related to that RRBs should be allowed to provide the credit to selected institutions such as local bodies or the housing boards, etc., besides the target group. And what is the target group of RRBs? That is the rural people. So such loans should be given only to the financially sound institutions and for the productive purposes alone. So this is the recommendation of the Kelkar Committee. Then we have the Mishra Committee. So what is about the Mishra Committee? So its major recommendation was in regard to the funds management in RRBs. So it said that a graduated investment by RRBs in the government securities should be there. An introduction of a special deposit scheme should also be there of 15 days maturity period for SLR investments of RRBs. It also focused on the widening the scope for the non-SLR investments of RRBs. So as you can see that all these four committees work towards the betterment of RRBs. But our question was that on whose recommendations were RRBs established? So let's see the answer then. So the answer to this question is option B, that is Narasimham Committee. Guys, do join our Telegram channel and group for free material. It will be really beneficial for you all in your examinations. Now moving on to the next question for today. Now this question relates to the financial management. So it says that capital budgeting techniques are divided based on the discounting and the non-discounting methods, as we all know. So what is the discounting method and non-discounting methods? The one which considers the time value of money, it is the discounting method. And the one which does not, it is the non-discounting methods. So the payback period method is one such type, and it is related to the non-discounting methods. So which of the following is true regarding the payback period method? So it is said that it is based upon all the cash flows. Payback period method is based upon earlier cash flows. Payback period method is based upon only higher cash flows. And payback period method is based upon the selected cash flows. Now through an example, let's see how the payback period method works in the next slide. So guys, if there is a case wherein 2 lakh rupees is the initial investment, but your cash flows are even, that is 20,000 is received every year. So the payback period method says that the number of years required for the proposal's cumulative cash inflows to be equal to its cash outflows. So when I'm saying that the annual inflows are equal, that is 20,000 each year, then dividing 2 lakh by 20,000, 10 years will be your payback period. But in case where there is unequal cash flows, so in this case, let's see how to calculate the payback period. So guys, here let's see that in the third year itself, 1,85,000 has been recovered of the total 2 lakh. Now, the difference between 1,85,000 and 2 lakh is 15,000 rupees. So we need to have 15,000 more to recover our initial investment. And in the fourth year, the cash inflow is 40,000. So dividing 15,000 by 40,000, it gives you 0.375. So therefore, 3 years and 0.375 months is required to recover the initial investment of 2 lakh. So this is our payback period. So this is really easy. But the main problem is that after this cash flow, it ignores all the other cash flows and it considers only the earlier cash flows and not all the cash flows. Plus, there is no criteria for the selection of cash flows, as in when the cash flows are there, it considers them. So there is no criteria for the selection. So the earlier cash flows, till the time the capital is recovered, it is considered. Now moving back to the question. So here the answer will be that payback period method is based upon the earlier cash flows. That is option B. Now moving on to the next question for today. The question says that Export Credit Guarantee Corporation of India provides export credit insurance support to Indian exporters. So which of the following is the correct option regarding the year in which ECGC was initially founded? So guys, earlier Export Risk Insurance Corporation was set up in the year 1957 to offer insurance to the exporters against exchange controls. And then in the year 1964, it was renamed to Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, that is ECGC. So in the question, it is asked that when was ECGC initially founded? So our answer will be option A, that is 1957, because only the rename was done in the year 1964 from Export Risk Insurance Corporation to ECGC. Now let's understand something more about ECGC in the next slide. So first let's discuss what is ECGC. So we all know that it is an export promotion organization which seeks to enhance the competitiveness of the Indian exports by offering them credit insurance covers. So this corporation was set up for ensuring smooth functioning of the Indian exporters by minimizing the risk associated with the payments emanating from other nations. Now, what does a ECGC do? So it offers a variety of credit risk insurance covers. It also provides export credit insurance covers to the banks and other financial institutions for enabling the exporters to find better services from them. Then moving on to how does ECGC help the exporters? So ECGC provides the insurance protection to the Indian exporters against the payment risk. So it helps the exporters in a number of ways, like guiding the export related activities or making information available with respect to various countries with its credit ratings, helping the Indian exporters recover the bad debt. So these are some of the ways in which ECGC helped the Indian exporters. I hope that you have understood that what is the main objective, purpose, motto of ECGC. Now, moving on to the last question for today. The question says that financial management means planning, organizing, directing, and controlling the financial activities such as procurement and utilization of funds of the enterprises. In financial management, term risk refers to... So guys, risk is anything where if we expect something in future, but it is happening not in direct tandem with our expectations and there is some variations. So this is the basic meaning of risk. So the meaning remains the same in finance as well. So option A says that variability of the future outcome, B says chances of incurring losses, and C says chances of incurring profits. So the basic meaning of risk says the variability of the future outcome. When we are not sure that what we have expected will turn out to be true or not, there is some variations in that. So that is risk. So in finance, there are two types of risk, that is systematic risk and unsystematic risk. Systematic risk is uncontrollable by any organization and it is macro in nature. Whereas if we talk about the unsystematic risk, then it is controllable by an organization and it can be mitigated by diversification of the portfolio. So in the systematic risk, we have three types of risk, that is interest rate risk, purchasing power risk, and market risk. Whereas if we talk about the unsystematic risk, then business risk is there, financial risk is there, and operational risk is there. So with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you liked the session and you were able to understand each and every concept explained in this video. If you like my video, then do subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon. Join our Telegram group for more free material. Thank you for watching my video.